35-year-old, that one stem cell will produce 32,000 cells on average. A 65-year-old would be 200, right? Huge differences. So if you're trying to get a lot of work done, then it's helpful to have cells that can double more often so that they can do more work. A decrease in stem cell function has also been recently shown to play a primary role in the cause of tissue aging and multiple diseases, such as anemia, sarcopenia, which is the loss of muscle mass commonly seen with age, and even osteoporosis, suggesting at least in part the cause of these diseases to be an imbalance between cell loss and cell renewal. Our number of circulating and functioning stem cells determines whether our bodies are regenerating or degenerating. So without the necessary number of stem cells, the axis will be tilted in the favor of degeneration. So if you need 10,000 stem cells to repair something in your body, like a painful knee injury, or even a chronic injury, and you only have 200 stem cells, well, you simply have a math problem. So not all stem cells are created equal. Even though you can harvest your own stem cells from bone marrow or even fat tissue, the therapeutic results will be significantly limited the older you are. Younger cells multiply faster. So if you're trying to get ahead of something, using younger, faster cells can help you get ahead of it more quickly. Also, harvesting your own stem cells, either from fat or bone, are invasive procedures. I have had this done. I thought that the fat one wasn't going to be that bad. It's terrible. It's no kidding.
If you have plenty of fat, it won't be as bad, right?
You know,
I mean,
it was pretty rough.
It was pretty rough.
It's a little picture.
Yeah, tell me why. I mean, what you said it was due to. I mean, you're locally anesthetized, so
yeah. So you
pressure.
You take this injection, right, and you anesthetize the area, and you make an incision, and then
right.
you stick this rod
uh-huh.
that's about that long.
Right.
And it's got some serious suction power behind it.
Liposuction.
It's liposuction.
It's not
yeah.
exactly what it is.
It's
yeah. People do it all the time.
They do it all the time.
Yeah.
I would...
For non-stealth reasons.
Right, right.
Yeah, but if you don't have enough fat, how could they get it?
Oh, they can get it.
Well, I mean, I have fat on my body. I mean,
I had
enough to
I'm
get it.
I'm sort of looking
you know?
Around this room. I think there's a lot to go around.
So, here's the deal. When I got done with it, I had... looked like I was in a motorcycle accident
yeah,
or something. Like
yeah,
I looked like I had just
right.
been tumbled in the street. I mean,
right.
I was completely bruised
right.
from here to here
that's
for 2 weeks. I mean, it was rough.
Yeah.
So you can do it.
Yeah.
I just think it's easier to open the vial. That's
yeah.
all I'm saying. And the cost isn't that different. The cost is not that different. So if you're over 40 or even 35, it doesn't make sense to me to do this. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, I think the important thing to remember is even though you might be anesthetized or something, I mean, it's an invasive procedure.
Yes.
You're sticking
yeah.
in
it
arms.
Is very invasive.
Yeah.
I felt
yeah.
violated.
Yeah.
Well, and the age of the cell. I mean,
right, I'm 40, you know.
That's
it's only so good.
Yeah.
Which we just
yeah.
saw, you know, the age of
yeah.
the cell plays a big part in it.
So yes, it's invasive. So rather than this, I propose this. Right? And again, since the age of the stem cell is one of the most significant things that determine the dividing and this healing potential, theoretically, it just makes more sense to use the younger cells in every case. So, and these are the most robust human stem cells available. Literature has clearly shown that.
But they're not yours.
Because they're from, well, I mean, unless you, your parents were...
Oh, right.
Really ahead
you
of the idea of and cryopreserved your own, you know, placenta and
okay.
umbilical cord, which, by the way, would only be half yours anyway, because the other half is your mom's.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, there's still going to be
yeah.
different DNA involved, which I'll talk about that in a little bit. So to be clear, right, because we're not talking about embryonic. We're not talking about fetal, so there's no lives are being taken to undergo these kind of therapies. They're basically using the placenta, umbilical cord, or even the cord blood, which, you know, until recently were just considered medical wastes. So there's no ethical problems or legal problems using these stem cells.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, so
yeah.
we're getting placentas and we're getting cord blood, And where exactly is that coming from? I mean, I understand where placentas and cord blood comes from, but I want to know where you're harvesting it from.
That is this slide. Good question.
Okay.
The stem cells come from healthy mothers that donate their placenta, cord, and cord blood. The mothers undergo rigorous testing for any viral or infectious diseases, and the stem cells themselves are tested for infectious diseases and sterility. Only about 1 in 10 placentas and cords pass these stringent tests. These are set up, these different donating facilities are set up in multiple states throughout the country. So the tissues that pass testing are then sent to an FDA-regulated lab for processing and concentration of the stem cells and other cellular growth factors. So again, it's not just the stem cells, the growth factors have a huge therapeutic advantage as well. So we use multiple labs depending on the specific types of tissues we're looking for and the growth factors needed for different conditions or even combinations of tissue types of either the placenta, cord, and cord blood cells and the growth factors.
Can you just talk about the difference between the fact that it's an FDA-regulated lab, but
correct,
the process is not FDA-regulated?
Absolutely. So due to the fact that stem cells are tissue products and they're not drugs, the FDA cannot approve or disapprove them. Stem cells and the related tissue products are considered experimental, but it's the FDA's responsibility to make certain that they're safe for people receiving these actual treatments.
Question. Do they keep multiplying after they're harvested?
Yes, under the right conditions. Not in the tube. Once they're in the tube, they're carefully frozen.
They can be grown.
But they can be absolutely replicated and grown for some time.
I have a question. Is that how they make a lot of it? After they get it, they grow a lot of it, and then they tube it?
Not typically, because they want that growing process to happen in the person that's receiving the treatment. So
once you have, once it's harvested, say your own stem cell, and you then freeze some, okay? How long, what is the lifespan of those stem cells?
If they're frozen at negative 80 degrees, it's
just
indefinite.
Indefinite, okay, okay.
So they don't degrade over time?
They don't if they're properly stored.
Properly stored.
Yeah, if they don't have that negative 80, that seems to be the magic number.
Okay.
So if it's like negative 20, negative 30, it's like 2 months, 3 months. Something like that is what the literature suggests.
Is the negative 80, is that what they consider cryogenic?
Yes.
Okay.
Can I just go back to the FDA thing?
Sure.
The FDA, from what you were saying, it sounds like they're not even trying to necessarily get to the point where they approve. It doesn't fall into the definition of things that they approve of. It's the lab, but it's not like someday down the road the actual stem cells will be approved because they're a tissue. It's just not something that's under their umbrella.
There was an article I saw 2 months ago that came out that said the FDA is trying to adapt to this new environment, and so they have worked with some of these tissue banks to have them go through the process to make this the same as an investigational new drug. So they are trying.
Well, then
that's
not good.
They have more debt.
That's not good.
And you know what?
Yeah.
Then all of this will be gone.
That's right.
Gone.
I didn't say I thought it was a good idea.
No, it's not a good idea.
Not a good idea.
Lobbyists.
No.
So the FDA is involved already.
Yes.
It's just they are definitely trying to increase their involvement.
But not over the actual material.
Correct.
Right. Yeah. That's the scary part. If they get a toehold in that, that's not good.
Yes.
Then Big Pharma comes right after that.
Well, so they're already involved.
Well,
did I answer your question?
Yes. Pfizer and Eli Lilly are already working with the INH to do just that.
And that's scary.
So in these FDA-regulated labs, the tissues are configured to these different flowable states, whether you're looking for an IV use or a local injection. IV use, you want to have really small cellular components because you don't want to cause any sort of clotting or any sort of problem like that. So a common question I hear about these stem cells, tissue, and growth factor therapies is, what if these are all too new to really know if they're going to cause something down the road, like an adverse effect, like maybe cancer? Or 20 years later. Human placenta tissues have been in clinical literature since 1910.
Wow.
This is ample time to demonstrate the safety of their use for healing. This is from a book published in 1910 of Johns Hopkins Hospital Reports. They reported successful tissue healing has been demonstrated for both fresh and dehydrated placenta tissues. Because of the growth factors present, the dehydrated ones even still work. So using these have been done and documented for over 100 years and is now becoming the standard of care in many fields.
Is this a lit review, what we're looking at?
These are hospital records.
Hospital.
They did 550.
Okay. All right.
Placenta.
So it's a retrospective look at hospital records.
Correct.
Okay.
Here, in 1913, placenta tissues, that's where the amniotic membranes come from. That's part of the placenta. They were used and recommended for skin burns and ulcers instead of skin grafts. 1950, this doctor wrote about the remarkable success that he had treating ulcers with placenta tissues since 1939. Chronic ulcers on the legs in elderly people are notoriously difficult to treat. He had bedridden patients from age 60 to 80 who had ulcers from anywhere from 4 to 15 years, were treated with placenta tissues and healed in 10 weeks.
Nice.
That's impressive, right? The doctor wrote that the placenta tissues possess some specific healing power. Probably didn't know about stem cells. So the placenta was used and recommended to be adopted by any hospital, regardless of its available facilities, to treat skin burns in 1979 because it is simple and superior to other grafts. Here, placenta tissues were successfully used and recommended for chronic leg ulcers, again, in 1980 because of the treatment's superiority. This study objectively shows what these doctors had been witnessing for over the last century when they claimed that the placenta tissues were superior for healing. So these doctors compared using placenta tissue versus bioengineered skin substitute or the standard of care for diabetic ulcers that were open for at least 4 weeks and were not healing. The standard of care was defined as basically debridement or removal of the dead tissue, and then they topically applied a collagen stimulating ointment or gel.
So this is dehydrated. So that's like, that's never living again. That's just because of the growth factors and those kinds of things.
Correct.
Right.
So as you'll see, there's a common theme that I see. When I look at these studies, I always think, well, what if you did that instead? What if you used the live ones? What if you used umbilical or placenta? And that's where this gets exciting, because if they're getting these kind of results with inferior treatments, I always consider, well, what is our real potential possibility? So here are the results. So after 6 weeks, 95% of the patients with the placenta membrane, again, the dehydrated one, achieved a complete wound closure. 45% of the skin substitute group achieved complete wound closure, and only 35% of the standard care group achieved complete wound closure. But more impressively, the placenta group completely healed to closure in 13 days on average, and the skin substitute and the standard care groups took 49 days to heal to closure on average. The average cost of the grafts was $1,600 per patient for the placenta group and over $9,000 for the skin substitute group, because the average placenta tissue patient only needed 2 grafts, and the average skin substitute patient needed 9 grafts to achieve closure. So in January 2018, more than a century later, right, placenta tissues are now touted as an ideal treatment for skin burns and ulcers. In 1940, placenta tissues were being used and recommended in scientific literature for repairing eye injuries after like a chemical or a heat burn. From that point on, the use of placenta tissues in ophthalmic surgery catapulted. In 2012, there were over 45,000 applications of placenta tissues used by ophthalmologists, including conjunctival reconstruction, burn treatment, glaucoma surgery, and wound healing. So without a doubt, the placenta tissues are being widely utilized in the field of ophthalmology.
So if I may, so with the eye, are you using a topical type membrane?
Correct.
Are you not doing an injection?
They have topical forms that are underneath a carrier, like a contact lens, like an oversized contact lens, or they just stick it directly to the eye, kind of like a patch.
Okay.
And
like
they
a
do that.
Lens.
They'll do that after surgeries. Mm-hmm. They'll do that without surgeries in order to heal. Mm-hmm. And they've been approved for like 9 different eye conditions.
Any optic nerve? Would regeneration or?
Yes, that's this one.
Wow.
So, not only was it able to improve the surface, but they also found that it improved neurological or nerve tissue kind of eye pain. So it seems that even the topical use of these, they go deep into tissues and they start repairing other tissues as well, not just the surface. And then doctors also started making placenta tissue injections. So they'll take the dehydrated membranes and then they'll put them into a powder that can be rehydrated. And then they started injecting them into people that had either muscle, tendon, or ligament pathologies, right? So for here, in this one, they used people that had plantar fasciitis, which is can be a very challenging and frustrating condition for both patients and doctors, since no single treatment is guaranteed to alleviate the pain. And they were given a localized injection of anesthesia, and then either a saline injection or the injection of the amniotic membrane. And then they had the patients complete these different hindfoot questionnaires that differentiate between just pain and function, not just pain, right?
So how do you measure the amount injected? Is it based on the pain intensity or the ailment location? Everyone gets a full
correct and
vial.
and basically what I'm saying is there's lots of different forms of these. And so that's where we use the literature to kind of guide us, but then at the same time, that's the beauty of medicine, is it is an art. And you can say, well, does it make sense to maybe do something similar, but maybe we can improve upon that? Maybe we can combine some stuff, maybe we can use something that's maybe we think is superior than what they used in the studies. So on this hindfoot questionnaire, again, we're looking at pain and function. And the higher the score, the better the patient feels. So after the first week, the placenta group had a 34-point average improvement on that questionnaire, where the anesthesia and saline group only had a 2-point improvement on average. And after 8 weeks, the placenta group had a 53-point average improvement, whereas the saline and anesthesia group had only a 13-point improvement. So it's significant, right? That's a definite significant difference. And to put that in perspective, there was a very similar study that was done, but they used corticosteroid injections, and that only produced a 30-point improvement compared to the 53-point improvement, just to compare the treatments.
And I'm sure with placenta, you don't get the atrophy of the muscle as you do with the corticosteroids.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It actually brings in these amniotic membranes act like a stem cell magnet, where they attract all these other healing tissues, white blood cells, platelets, and everything to come to the area. And when you do these treatments, the area inflames. It can be very uncomfortable for the first few days.
Oh, really?
Uncomfortable is probably downplaying it.
Mm-hmm.
When you get the shots, it becomes uncomfortable?
Yes, okay.
When you use the dehydrated version of this, it becomes very inflamed.
Okay, so you want the one that's liquid, right?
Depends on what you're going for.
Well, I want one.
but
I don't want to be inflamed.
Right. So there are those versions as well. So as I said before, you can get stem cells from bone marrow. Bone marrow transplants are most often performed for patients that have certain cancers of the blood or bone marrow, such as multiple myeloma or leukemia. These patients are typically treated with chemotherapy or radiation or both, and that unfortunately destroys their own stem cells. So after treatment, they need a bone marrow transplant to restore their pool of bone marrow stem cells. In 1997, a landmark case was reported in a patient who had both multiple sclerosis, or MS, and cancer. So she had this for 29 years, and these were her symptoms. She had recurrent right optic neuritis. She had episodic vertigo, so she's losing her balance and kind of thing. Persistent left-sided sensory abnormalities. She couldn't feel her left arm and her left leg. She had progressive decline in motor skills, balance, and memory. This is a MRI that shows this localized lesion. It's a periventricular lesion right here that's correlates with disease activity of multiple sclerosis. And on the right, the MRI shows multiple areas of increased signal, which we call generalized lesions, in the periventricular white matter. So these represent areas of active or chronic demyelination of the nerves, which is characteristic of MS. So MS.
This is not the same brain.
Same brain.
Yeah. It is.
Yeah, just different scans, different areas of it.
Okay, different
so,
views.
Correct, like one's a little higher than the other.
Okay.
And with that, with MS, there's a like a rubber coating on the nerves sort of thing that you see in electrical wires, mm-hmm. and the immune system attacks that little insulation or rubber coating kind of thing. So that's what we say when we say demyelination. So she was diagnosed with bone marrow cancer in a chronic phase and underwent high-dose chemotherapy and had a bone marrow transplant from her brother. After the bone marrow transplant, not only did she have no MS symptom flare-ups, but many things that she had for years improved. So after 4 months, her eye movements and left-sided sensory deficits had improved on neurological examination. After 12 months, her memory, thought processes, and organizations improved, as did many other neurological tests. So specifically, her hyperreflexes, eye movements, and sensations of her left arm and leg normalized. Her pale optic nerve was the only thing that didn't change. But functionally, everything improved in regards to the MS. So 12 months after the bone marrow transplant, the enhanced periventricular lesion had resolved. But not everything, but those stable ones did not. But the other one that was progressing seemed to have improved, or I say completely resolved. But there were no new lesions after the bone marrow transplant. So in summary, after 12 months of a bone marrow transplant, her cancer was in remission, she was off all immunosuppressive medications, her MS symptoms improved, and her neurological exam was functionally normal. This case spurred other doctors to start trying stem cells primarily for MS. By 2013, doctors had learned a lot about stem cells for MS and wrote that stem cell therapy had been shown to reduce or eliminate ongoing clinical relapses, halt further progression, and reduce the burden of disability in some patients that have aggressively highly active MS in the absence of chronic treatment with disease-modifying agents.
Can you go back to that other slide for a minute? How would you...
This one?
Yeah, get up off all immunosuppressants.
Yes, so when you have a bone marrow transplant, you try to match it with a couple factors, like the HLA factor.
Right.
And just in case you're wrong, they typically put people on immunosuppressants, even if they think they're not going to have a problem. And then the trial is, after the transplant, everything kind of stabilizes, then you slowly wean the patient off the medications, and then you keep track if they need the medication or not. So that's why. So many people that have a bone marrow transplant can, in fact, get off immunosuppressive treatment later on.
Okay.
Is that for anti-rejection? Also?
Correct. So
okay. Now
you typically
it.
Don't
okay.
see this in other organ transplants.
Getting off of it.
There's something
right.
there's something different about bone marrow transplants, umbilical transplants, and placental transplants that we'll get into that in a little bit
right.
too. So by 2017. Over 750 stem cell transplants, primarily for MS, had been reported in the medical literature. And these doctors did a meta-analysis of all the studies that were properly reported, and here's their results. They defined this NEDA as no evidence of disease activity, and they have 83% of the people that had bone marrow transplants had no evidence of disease activity after 2 years. And at the 5-year mark, 67% had no evidence of disease activity. So those authors concluded that the largest benefit risk profile in patients with aggressive MS with a relapsing remitting course and who have not yet accumulated a high level of disability would most likely be good candidates for bone marrow stem cells. Now, what's really interesting about this to me is that these are mostly from the original patient. They didn't use somebody else's. So the only one that really reported somebody else's was the woman that had the MS. And her results seem to be a little bit better than some of these other ones. So what they'll do is they'll take these patients and they get their stem cells from their bone marrow, and then they bank them, they freeze them, and then after the patient undergoes the treatment, they put them back in. And somehow that resets something and it fixes a lot of issues with a lot of patients, but not everybody. So in theory, it seems that, you know, using somebody else's stem cells would probably give better results. Unfortunately, these studies just haven't been done in massive amounts.
Was the brother the same age or younger?
I don't know. That's a good question.
I bet he was younger.
Mm-hmm. Well, either way, it was different and,
yeah,
it worked. So here, researchers showed that the placenta stem cells, when they started comparing different types of stem cells, have more immunomodulating effects compared to cord stem cells. And since MS typically involves a dysfunctioning immune system, it would make sense to try placenta stem cells as well for MS. So that's what researchers did. They started the process for studying placenta stem cells for MS by first conducting a safety trial. And here are the highlights. So their preclinical model suggests that the placenta stem cells as the PSC may lead to immunomodulation and repair in MS. That they did infusion, so they did these placenta stem cells IV, appears to be safe and well tolerated in patients with MS, and there's no worsening that was shown. And unfortunately, as in most phase one trials, the study was not designed to determine how effective the treatment was, just that it was shown to be safe. So a clinical trial is planned with these same researchers to explore the actual feasibility and the dosing to get that right as well. So that's currently planned. These same authors also did a really fantastic study on Crohn's disease with stem cells. So in humans, the first trial for stem cells in the knee was a male patient with moderate to severe knee osteoarthritis in 2008. And since then, there have been 11 other studies that had been reported, and these authors did an analysis, and they concluded that all three studies regarding osteoarthritis and all eight studies regarding a focal chondral defect, so something specifically in the joint that was wrong with the cartilage, reported good to excellent overall outcomes with the use of bone marrow stem cells. And in 2010, there was another impressive case report published on rheumatoid arthritis. It was a 67-year-old woman with rheumatoid arthritis, had severe pain and swelling in her fingers, both ankles and knees, difficulty walking even short distances, limited by pain, and there was stiffness in her hands and wrists, especially upon rising, which is classic for rheumatoid arthritis, and it was progressively worsening fatigue. She had excess sleeping, redness of both hands. Her labs showed she had an abnormal rheumatoid factor that was elevated, 75, where your normal is want to be 39 and under. And then she also had a CCP antibody, which was greater than 250. And she underwent two fat-derived stem cell IVs in two sequential days.
Her own?
Her own.
Okay.
At 67.
67. And there were no side effects, but on day two, there was considerable resolution of her pain and stiffness. And day three, she was walking normally with no pain or symptoms. And after 15 months, the doctor reported that she trains daily with a personal trainer without limitations, and her labs had shown some improvement as well. The rheumatoid factor reduced, not quite in the normal range, but improvement, and then same with her CCP antibodies. So, in veterinary medicine, stem cell therapy is an accepted therapeutic modality and reports typically an 8% improvement rate. And over 4,000 horses and 4,000 dogs with various cartilage and bone injuries have been successfully treated and reported in medical literature. So here, not too surprising, they did a study with 172 patients with active rheumatoid arthritis who had an inadequate response to traditional medicines. And so there was two groups. They did first a group that just stayed on their disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, or DMARDs, what they call them, and they basically showed that that group had no significant changes. And then they had people that wanted to do stem cells, so they did the DMARD, or I'm sorry, they were randomized. They didn't have a choice. This was a randomized trial. So they had the DMARDs plus the umbilical stem cells, and they did these IV. And it induced remission, according to the American College of Rheumatology improvement criteria, And there's also a 28 joint disease activity score and a health assessment questionnaire that had improved. And they show that the effects maintained for 3 to 6 months without continuous administration. Then they took people and they gave some another round in the group that had the stem cells. They gave them a second round of stem cells, and they showed that repeated infusions enhanced the therapeutic efficacy. And again, there were no serious side effects on this, and it showed that it decreased the tumor necrosis factor alpha and interleukin 6, and it also increased certain regulatory T cells like CD4 cells, CD25s.
How often can you get a dose, if you will?
There's not much guidance on that.
Okay, I'm just curious. So yep. It really depends on the physician.
Correct. In the literature, what I have seen, the most sequential administration of this is daily for 7 days. Mm-hmm. I've seen
but
daily IVs
dosage?
For 7 days.
But at what dosage?
It varies.
Okay.
The one I'm talking about was from cord blood. So.
And this is traditional science with RA is an autoimmune disease, which is often affected by diet. And so
sure.
I'm guessing that any kind of food-related or diet-related study in this study was probably not conducted
right.
because it's typical of this.
They try to tell everybody not to do anything different, right?
Right.
They try to keep track of that in the study design.
Okay.
And most people don't if they're not directed to.
Right. Okay.
And again, when you're talking about large groups, it helps kind of weed out those other factors that might be playing a role.
Right.
But definitely, you know, life is multifactorial.
For sure.
So
yeah,
it's
yeah.
hard. The conclusion here on this study was DMARDs plus umbilical stem cells may provide safe, significant, persistent clinical benefits for patients with active RA. The other thing that's interesting is there was also a third treatment group that they showed in the study, and that was the patients that couldn't tolerate their DMARDs, and they came off of them, and even though they had the stem cells, they also improved without the DMARDs. So if they ended up study design was three groups, it ended up being four. So the old stem cell model was that stem cells could regenerate tissue, which is why they can heal ulcers, which is why they can, you know, repair tissue. They can also prevent premature cell death, and that's also how they help burns, and they can reduce scarring. But how do they help MS, osteoarthritis, and rheumatoid arthritis? And the answer is because all these conditions have a common threat, inflammation. So I didn't realize when I started getting into stem cell therapies that they actually reduce inflammation for months to years at a time. In 2011, researchers found that autistic children have more inflammation than non-autistic children, and it should be surprising then at that point that a doctor gave stem cells to a severely autistic boy and had a positive benefit. So it was his own bone marrow stem cells. There were no side effects, and some improvements occurred in the first week, such as the boy's eye contact with other people, attention, handwriting, and fine motor activities like buttoning the shirt, and he had significant improvements at 6 to 12 months. So after 6 months, his aggression and activities, hyperactivity reduced 45 to 50%. There were improvements in impulse control, reading skills, tracing, recognition of all shapes, and following commands were noted. His score on the CARS, which is a questionnaire they use for autism, it reduced from 42 points, which is severely autistic, to 23.5 points, which is just barely under the mild autistic, but the doctor concluded that he still clinically was mildly autistic. Yes.
Tell me again, where did the cells come from? Him?
Bone marrow. His own bone marrow.
Interesting.
And then here, these are the pre and post PET scans that he had, which these scans show activity in the brain. And so you can definitely see that the bottom ones, right, they got a lot more light. There's a lot more activity going on in all areas of the brain. So after 1 year, he was found to interact more with his peers. His peer activity had increased significantly. New task learning abilities improved, which was also noted in his increased participation in household work. And he was following commands better, and he had developed self-insight, which he never had before. So in conclusion, all these improvements have led, this is what the doctor who did the therapy, led to improved quality of life of the patient as well as the family, and several incurable neurological disorders have been shown beneficial, right, with cellular therapy. Since then, since that report, 10 clinical trials using stem cells or mononuclear cells, which are similar, to treat autism have been registered. In a 2017 textbook entitled Neurological Regeneration, there's an entire chapter dedicated to stem cell therapy for autism. So it shows the kinds of cells or the stem cells used to date are mononuclear cells from the bone marrow, the umbilical cord, blood cells, fetal stem cells, and mesenchymal, or again, the adult stem cells from the umbilical cord itself. So what you don't see on here is placenta, which is theoretically one of the best sources. So conclusion is transplantation of these cells significantly improves some scores in autistic patients. Similarly, many chronic lung conditions have been found to be inflammatory conditions as well, including asthma, allergic rhinitis. And because they are inflammatory, it's been proposed that stem cells can help these conditions as well. And there are currently clinical trials using stem cells for lung conditions, and the results so far have been reported and encouraging. So we talked again in the beginning about possibility of rejection, right? This graft versus host disease. That's GVHD is the abbreviation for that. So it begs the question, right? Are someone else's stem cells safe? Researchers have found that 100% of mothers have stem cells from every baby they have carried for up to 50 years in their blood and tissues. And the increased stem cells are the proposed reason for mothers living longer than non-mothers. So although it was shown that mothers live longer, it was also thought that maybe these mothers have more autoimmune diseases because of these circulating stem cells that aren't their own. So mothers live a third of a year longer for every child they have, up to 14 children, which sounds a little overwhelming.
A lot is empty.
Yeah. I guess after 14, there's something stem cells can't fix.
What?
Brain's gone.
But since the fetal stem cells are found at these mothers' diseased or injured tissues, it was originally thought that they may induce these autoimmune conditions. But since then, this has been disproven. So there was a report of a woman who had severe graft versus host disease, and the researchers decided to try to treat her with stem cells. And transplantation was successful. Doctors wrote, clinical response was striking. The patient is now well after a year, and we postulate that, right, these stem cells have a potent immunosuppressive effect in real life, which is in vivo. And then again, because the fetal stem cells are found in disease or injured tissue, they originally thought that they were possibly the cause of that. But then now the science suggests that rather than triggering the diseases, these stem cells are more likely combating the disease. They're actually helping the conditions.
Awesome.
So just like mothers benefit from baby stem cells, transplanted placenta cord or cord blood stem cells can reduce inflammation and modulate the immune system in addition to helping many conditions that even require new tissue generation. So that's how